What is up, NLC Lab? My name is Richard Eberle, and my wife and I have the honor and privilege of pastoring our middle school students at the Conway campus. That's our 412 ministry, and that's for our 5th through 7th graders, and we absolutely love what we get to do. So today, I want to take a moment to look into what God's Word has for us. I want to kind of like, as they've kind of shown you a little bit of things that they do, for me, I'm kind of like old school. I cannot read digitally, so I use like a paper Bible. So for me personally, this is my Bible. You can see it's kind of used. I put duct tape on it to keep it together, but it is an ESV. I love it. But also when I'm reading, I usually have a couple things with me. I use sticky notes. You can see in my Bible, I'm going to turn it upside down, but I'm constantly writing things in there, sticky notes. When I'm at like my house reading in the place that I read, like I'll keep a message version with me. Bring back old school teen study Bible. That's right, circa 1990s. Something that I try to do is I try to pick a place that I'm consistent with in a time of the day that I try to keep consistent. Not like a ritual, but it's like a constant place that I know that allows me to get my mind right where I meet with the Lord. My other place is a little unique and different, and it was very consistent through my early 20s and in my college years, and that was Waffle House. Yes, promise, got the cup to prove it. There was no internet there. You can't beat bottomless mediocre coffee and reading the Word. So that's where I would go. Over time, if you're consistent with this, the quantity will come. This is not something you're gonna read once and, oh, I'm done, it's another book, throw it on the shelf. Like, no, this is a book that we want to read for a lifetime. Like, this is something I'll never know the depths of all who God is. It's kind of like my wife. This book, the Bible, can be intimidating, and asking my wife out was a little intimidating. She's a doctor. Like, man, she's way smarter than I ever was. I can't read the Bible because I don't know anything about it. I didn't know anything about my wife except, wow, I want to get to know this girl. So you know what I did? I asked her out, and it was through dates, spending time with her, that I got to know her character, what she liked, her thoughts and opinions. God's Word is so good. It's shallow enough for babes to wade in without drowning, but it's deep enough that theologians can jump in and never touch the bottom. Like, we're never going to know everything about it, but what a cool journey that I get to have, that God's written a letter to me that I get to dive in, study in, and try to get to know Him the rest of my life. Let's get started on this journey and jump into our verse of the day. Revelation 3:20 says this. Jesus is speaking. He says, "Here I am. I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in and eat with that person and they with me." Revelation 3:20. In Revelation chapter 3, he's talking to a church called Laodicea. So he's talking to believers. Like, he is talking to Christians. He says, "You're lukewarm Christians. You're neither hot nor cold, and I want to spit you out of my mouth." Jesus isn't like saying, "Oh, I'm going to come at you." But here's what he's saying. Like, just like coffee, I want to either drink hot coffee or cold brew. I don't want to drink coffee that is room temperature. It's like blah, like gross. Like, and if you like that, you're weird. Maybe at one point in your life, man, you are on fire for the Lord. You go to church, you go through the motions, but you're not sharing God's Word. You're not passionately pursuing Him. You're not spending time with Him. You're not letting God speak to you or work through you or move in you, and you're just going through the motions. But honestly, maybe you've got one foot in the world. Like, man, you've let a sin get a hold of you. You're living in an addiction. You've fallen in this trap of, well, I know Jesus, that's good enough. I want to live like everybody else. Man, God loves us too much to let us stay there. We even see Jesus pursuing these people. So let's go through some of these questions now that we understand a little bit of the context of what's going on. Is there a command to obey? Well, when I look at this passage, Jesus says, "Here I am, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens a door, I will come and eat with him." So apparently they're closed off. Like, Jesus can't even get into his own church. He's like sitting there knocking. I think the command is to, man, open up our life to Jesus. To be honest, if I'm honest with myself, when I keep Jesus at a distance, man, I'm arrogant. I fall into sin. I'm self-righteous. Man, I'm judgmental. I go through the motions, and I'm susceptible to so many things that the enemy wants to destroy. The sin to avoid is pushing Jesus away. When we fail sometimes and we recognize that we can't meet God's standard, man, shame creeps in, or there's areas that God's asking to invite us to let open and we want to still hold on to, we keep them at a distance, we thwart ourselves from moving forward in all that God has for us. Like, if my little daughter, if she learns to start walking, how terrible of a father would I be when she fell down and say, "Hey, Finn, hey, check this out. I don't think you're cut out for this whole walking thing." That's terrible. Here's what Jesus is inviting. He's knocking on the door, and a lot of times we're afraid to let him in because we think he's just gonna do something to hurt us. But here's what you need to know. Jesus is wanting in. He's wanting to build a relationship with you, you to get to know him so you can trust him. Because here's what I know this. Whoever knows him best will trust him most. And here's what Jesus is inviting. I'm giving you an invitation to trust me so that the areas of your life I want to clean up, that you know that I'm for your good. Is there something new about God you've never seen in this passage? Well, yeah, like he's not coming at me to condemn me. He's coming at me to spend relationship with me. So here's the application that I get from this context of scripture is this, that God is not done with me. It says this in Ephesians 2:10, that in Christ I have been made new. I'm a new workmanship, his masterpiece, created in Christ Jesus, or recreated in Christ Jesus, to do good works, which God has prepared in advance for me. Let me pray for you, that we would receive these promises and look at his word and learn from this. You're trying to help me learn how to walk as a little child, and God, I'm thankful for that. So God, help me not to run from that, or help me not to be afraid, but God, help me to constantly be willing, and help anybody that's out there be willing to invite you in, because God, you want in, and God, you want to work this, because God, you're not done with me, and you're not done with the people that are out there now listening to this. God, you have plans for them, not to make them, to get them to heaven, but God, because of what you did, they have eternal life, and now you have purpose for them in this life, and they can change. But that change happens through time with you in your presence and listening to you. Because he or she who knows you best will trust you most. And so that's what it is. You're inviting us to trust you. It's in your name. Amen. Come on. Come on. You're doing so good. You're doing so good. Can you say like and subscribe? Can you say like and subscribe?